church, ushers, choir members, musicians, and all you God's sons and daughters, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Come on, let's celebrate your 119th anniversary. In the First Baptist Church of North Tulsa. Amen. We're excited to be here. Your pastor is my friend.
Yes, sir.
And from the moment I met him in Oklahoma City, he embraced me not only as a friend, but I did not know I was gaining a brother.
Amen.
I praise God for friendship and fellowship and relationship.
Amen. Amen.
I don't want to hold you. Time is growing late and there is dinner prepared. And it's dangerous to keep a waiting black church. I'm hungry too. Amen. We have heard songs from Zion, beautiful tributes. First Baptist, you have a precious history, and we celebrate you on today. Unique message for the day. Turn with me to the second epistle of John. Second John. This is not a normal anniversary message, but I'm on assignment from the Lord God our Father. I just want to encourage First Baptist family, Pastor Scott.
Yes, sir.
All of you. Yah Shaddai has been wonderful on today. Second John, I want to look at the seventh verse.
Yes, sir.
We're going to pick apart a couple verses and then we're going to eat that chicken.
Yes,
touch your name and say, chicken is on the way. If you say amen, we can get to it. I hope Pastor told you that I don't have no sense.
No, sir.
But that's after I get to preach. Second time, you got your Bibles and your smartphones? Okay, now listen. If Tyrone texts you, young lady, if Sheila texts you, young man, don't move from the Word of God. Stay right there with the Word. Tell Tyrone you in church, he should have came with you. Tell that woman she should have came with you.
Right.
Hold your Bibles there. Let's look at this. Word prayer before we read. Lord God, bless us in your word. Amen.
Amen.
Verse 7. For many deceivers have gone out into the world. Do not confess Jesus Christ as coming in the flesh. This is a deceiver and an antichrist. Look to yourselves that we do not lose those things we worked for, but that we may receive a full reward. Whoever transgresses and does not abide in the doctrine of Christ does not have God. He who abides in the doctrine of Christ has both the Father and the Son. If anyone comes to you and does not bring this doctrine, do not receive him into your house, nor greet him. For he who greets him shares in his evil deeds.
All right.
I want to preach guarding the fellowship.
Guarding
the fellowship. Just do me a favor. Just say out loud, preacher.
Preacher
is going to preach about 15 minutes. Guarding the fellowship. In this unique epistle, John the Beloved, the last man standing. All the disciples have been martyred.
All right.
But there is one who has left standing.
Yes, sir.
John, the brother of James, the son of Zebedee and Salome.
Salome.
John, this fisherman by tree.
Yes, sir.
John, who was at the cross of Jesus. John, who witnessed a vacated tomb. John, who has saw the resurrected Savior, our Lord and God, Jesus the Christ. John writes this second epistle to to a church that's facing persecution.
All right.
But persecution was not just the problem, but the problem was that was inside persecution.
All right.
And what do you do when the fellowship has been penetrated?
Come on, man.
What do you say when the fellowship has been caught off guard? What do you do? And what do you say? John picks up his pen. Mm-hmm. Begins to write this particular letter.
All right.
We know about the gospel of John. We know about his writing in 1 John, 2 John, and that, or 3 John. But this unique pen, short letter, mm-hmm, written to a particular person or a church. The way he writes this particular letter, he does not pin himself as the author. Mm-hmm. Normally when we look at some writers, we'll see John, the Apostle of Jesus Christ, Paul, Apostle of Jesus Christ. But in this particular letter, if you look closely, he calls himself the elder.
All right.
Not only does he call himself the letter, the elder rather, but he does pin this to the elect lady.
Uh-huh.
Now, there are many theological suppositions that have been given about this elect lady and who this lady is, or perhaps a particular church, or perhaps another theological supposition I like, that perhaps there was a certain group that John did not want authorities to get a hold of.
Uh-huh.
In other words, he writes this letter in such a way so that in case this letter was intercepted, no one will be done any harm to you.
All right.
So he writes this letter encouraging this group in the faith, commending them, but then he gives a message of warning.
Amen.
Now, when we look at this, who is John that he should write such a letter? When you think about the person of John the Beloved, or John the Gospel Writer, as we call him, John was a unique disciple. When we look at Scripture and look at the person of John was one who was quiet and sat at the feet of Jesus.
You're right.
Unlike Peter, not saying that Peter's a bad guy, but Peter had times when he would put his foot in his mouth.
Right.
We call him the foot-shaped disciple. The foot-mouth-shaped disciple. He always had his foot in his mouth. But John was unique. John was so unique that when they tried to kill him, John just would not. They tried to poison John, and John would not die. They put him in a Patron copper kettle and tried to boil him to death, and he still would not die. And when that would not help, they put him out on an island called Patmos, and he still didn't die. John, here, the last man standing, has evidence of the reality of Jesus Christ. If you look at the gospel writings, Matthew talks about Jesus from the perspective of Abraham. Luke talks about him from the perspective of Adam. But when John talks about him, he says, in the beginning was God, the Son, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And he goes on further to validate who the Word is. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, full of grace and truth. And that's what this argument is about. This is an argument that deception has crept in the church, and that's why it's important to guard the fellowship. What he's saying, our churches are under crises. Why? Because all kinds of ideologies and doctrines have crept into our churches, and we have to be careful of who we lend our spiritual ear to. Everybody's not worthy for your spiritual ear. And I've got news for you. If you're watching a Word on the Word Network, baby, you're not going to find one on the Word Network. Here it is. We're living in times where doctrine has been destroyed. Where Jesus Christ has been distorted. And the particular problem was there were these deceivers. These deceivers. Did you see that in verse 7? You got your Bibles open? Stay with me, beloved. These deceivers. There was a doctrine that had crept forth from that of the Gnostics called Docetism. Docetism was a doctrine that taught that Jesus did not come in the flesh.
All right, sir.
Did you look at verse 7? I ain't got to argue with you. Just look at verse number 7. Verse number 7 says, for many deceivers, have gone out into the world. In the flesh. But these are the two deniers that we have. There is always a denial of his deity. In other words, those are the ones who preach that he's just a mere prophet. That he was a man, that he was just a good man, a mere prophet, but he was not God. But then there are those who says, well, he was all deity, he was all God. And because he's all God, then it makes all physical matter evil. And since matter is evil, it is impossible for him to remain sinless, so he did not have human flesh. Well, beloved, if my Lord and my Savior, if Jesus Christ did not come in the flesh, then why are we here this morning? Can I preach it in? Why are we here this morning if Jesus didn't come in the flesh? What I love about studying about the life of Christ is this. What I love about it is it blows my mind, brother preachers, because he was all God and all man at the same time. Watch this. He was so much God that he could calm the sea. But he was so much man that he had to go to sleep. He was so much God that he could pour fish out of fish. But he was so much man that he had to eat of the fish. He was so much God that he could change water to wine. Yes, sir. But he was so much man that he had to drink of the water. He was so much God that he could walk on the water. Yeah, but he was so much man that he had to partake of the water. In other words, Jesus is not like anybody else because he's all Bible said this man had been lame for quite some time. But if you move in chapter 4, Peter begins to preach.
Yes.
Why? Because those individuals who were there want to give Peter and John glory for what the Lord had done.
All right.
Peter corrects them afterwards with his whole sermonic presentation. But in Acts chapter 4, the Sanhedrin Council had an issue with Peter and John.
All right.
Why? Because just days ago, they killed Jesus.
Mm.
So they thought that they killed Jesus.
Come on.
But the same Jesus, when you call his name, he don't have to be present. But you just call his name. And because he is omnipresent, it's something about when you call on that name. Things don't remain the same when you call on that name. But I tell you right now to just say his name. You can't say his name without a smile coming out of your face, because something happens when you call the name of Jesus. In the shower. ritual traditionalisms. But when you come here, it's because the Lord has set a man in the house. And he has spent time with the Lord, that man. And that man has a message from the Lord. And the thing about the message is, you may not like the message, but you gotta hear from the messenger. There is preaching that corrects. There is preaching that rebukes. And it all goes along according to God's plan. And in other words, I have a 13-year-old daughter. Pray for me. Oh, mother, I'm going through. She ain't bad. I can't get it together. Lord Jesus. I was 13 before.
All right.
I just got to get back when I just grow. Well, listen here, beloved. I did not grow that child by feeding her candy every day.
Yeah.
One of the best things that happened to me is the day my daughter said, Daddy, I don't eat McDonald's no more.
All right.
That's some junk.
All right. Oh,
yeah. Stay with me now. You gotta say, I don't want candy sweets no more. I don't want a temporary fix. I don't just want an emotional high. But I want a word that's gonna change and challenge my life. That's what's happening. We have pulpits that are standing on truth, but yet looking to fill a pew and entertain. And all we're doing is handing out spiritual pain. If the truth would be told, listen, you can't stray from the truth.
Amen.
Now, there's one thing I love about truth is, the truth is the truth, and there's no lie in the truth.
Amen.
It is the truth. And when the truth is being told, you can't reject. You may not want to hear it, but it is the truth.
Amen.
We're living in times now that nobody wants the truth.
Right.
So how do we guard the fellowship? We have to know our doctrine. Now notice this, when I say doctrine, it's more to it than articles of faith. We have to understand Christian doctrine.
You're right.
That comes from the Word of God.
You're right.
I ain't coming to that one. But it says, listen, they do not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. Now watch this. How they come in is because they come in looking like those who are part of us.
All right.
They know the language.
Yeah.
And they also know what you know. And so they come in. Yeah, my man just said it. Wolves and sheep come in. They come in speaking the point. But they're not confessing the same thing.
Amen.
That word confessing, it takes them to the Greek word homologeo. Homo meaning same, legeo meaning word or same speech. In other words, they're not saying the same thing, or they're not speaking the same thing that we are speaking. They don't confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. But I need to pull the house today. What does she call Greenwood?
Yes, sir.
Before we leave out Greenwood, I know you've been here 119 years, but do you know Jesus?
Amen.
Now, you say, Pastor, what you mean? Now, let me tell you what I'm talking about now. I'm 39 years old. My father pastored all my life. But I can tell you that I knew about Jesus.
Amen.
But I didn't know Jesus.
Amen.
There is a difference.
Amen.
And knowing about him.
Amen.
And knowing him.
Yes.
So I'm going to ask you one more time. How many in your room know?
Yes, sir.
Know Jesus.
Yes, sir.
If you don't know him, it's a good day to hang around.
Yes.
And let me talk to you about him. Yes. So we got to know about the same thing I saw in the text is, he says, verse 2, look to yourselves. Y'all see that? Don't look at me, look at the Bible. You see that? Some of y'all standing at the bottom here. Look down. Now look at your phone. Stop texting. Put them games up.
Yeah.
I know I ain't never coming back. Pastor, y'all afraid? Yeah, I don't bring them back. Look to yourself. Y'all see that right now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And anyways, this word look, plepo, in the Greek text simply means to discern. In other words, it means use your human wisdom. He says, yes. Look to yourself. And this is why. That we do not lose those things which we have worked for, but that we may receive a full reward. And in other words, you need to give some spiritual inventory about what you've taken in. You have to have a watchful eye and a careful ear and know your doctrine. I know this ain't the right version of this. Second thing I saw in the text is that you have to know your boundaries. Look there in verse 9. It says, whoever transgresses. You know what's in there right
now? Come on.
Y'all ain't looking at me. Whoever transgresses and does not abide in the doctrine of Christ does not have God. He who abides in the doctrine of Christ has both the Father and the Son. He says, whoever transgresses. I like this word, transgresses. Perimino in the Greek text, it simply means to go beyond or to go aside. To go beyond or to go. In other words, it's all about staying in your boundary.
Amen.
In other words, there are some Oklahoma Sooner fans in the room.
Yes, sir.
I know I'm right, man. I'm in Oklahoma territory. My grandfather is a native of Eagletown, Oklahoma. I had an uncle here named Albert Lewis that cut hair for years here in Tulsa. Went to St. Andrews. That's my great uncle. Passed away some years ago. Everybody know the Lewis family, LWIs? Those are my people. I'm a Lewis. Luther Lewis, my granddaddy. So I know about Oklahoma Sooner football. But I also know last night as we were watching the game, as Kansas scored on y'all first.
All
right. And I was giving your pastor the business because he was dressed like he was an offensive coordinator. I'm making fun of him, I'm just messing with him. All Kansas scored. But we saw that in football, there are some boundaries.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is it a 100-yard field?
Yeah.
I'm a basketball player. That's a 100-yard field. But you can only play within the bounds. And the minute you step out of bounds, the whistle is blown, the clock is stopped, and the play is over, and you have to get back in. Transgression means that we have to know our boundaries. We can allow things to tickle our ear because it takes us out of the boundary that God has for us. And what has happened through the years? The church has steady gone out of bounds. What is up to us to guard the fellowship so that there can be a fellowship? I get inspired because you know, across the country, churches, you know, there's no longer a strong every Sunday goer. According to the new stats, regular church attendance is 2 Sundays a month. You got a first Sunday crowd, second Sunday crowd, third Sunday crowd, fourth Sunday crowd. Fifth Sunday, like rolling dice. Whoa, 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 whoa. But this is why I get excited. Because Jesus told Peter, he said, upon this rock, I will build my church. And the gates of hell, watch this, shall not prevail. It didn't say that hell would drop. But it said that it would not prevail. I hang my hope.
I love that class, Christology. When I was in that class in Christology, I love that class because it taught us about, the pre-incarnation of Christ. It showed us his existence before his physical existence. Then, that was the person in Christ incarnate. What it showed us, his deity and his humanity. Then, that was the incarnation of Christ. How God humbled himself and took on human form and came through the womb of a woman. That's how I know he's flesh. Because Mary gave birth to a fleshly child. Yes, sir. But not only that, but we go on and we talk about salvation through Jesus Christ and whatnot. We talk about it all day long. But we have to have this doctrine. Because it says whoever has this doctrine has the Father and the Son. I got to move on now. My time is up. But the last thing is you got to know who you're entertaining.
You
looked at the verse. Next time I do a little better. Please, Mother, tell Pastor to have me back, Mother. I'm putting it in the window. Just tell Pastor. That's between me and you now, Mother. Right, Pastor, give me another chance. Thank you, brother. Listen to me. This is verse 10. That's it. If anyone comes to you and does not bring this doctrine, that's it. Do not receive him into your house, nor greet him. For he, who greets him shares in his evil deeds. I'm out of here. Lord is good.
Yes, sir.
But you gotta know who you are entertaining.
Amen.
There's one thing I appreciate about the Jehovah's Witness. I appreciate because they can share their beliefs. But the minute they come into the house of a believer, or the moment they come, across someone who has some belief, they are taught to shut it down and to walk away. Well, beloved, we have to know how to shut it down. And we have to know, how to walk away. A few years ago, I've been pastoring a little church, St. Louis, for the past 8.5 years now. And you know how it goes when a new pastor comes to town. Church start, it don't grow, it swells. People coming, showing up, cars parked all down the street. And behind the place where I serve sits a mosque. So the leader of the mosque, he comes to the church one Sunday morning. Pastor Scott, when he showed up, came and he sat there in the chair in the aisle and he listened. He had his arms folded and he listened. Showed no emotion, but he sat there and he listened. Shook his head from time to time, but he listened. After church was over with, he got on out of there. The next Sunday, he came back. This time, he brought some of his, I don't know if they call them members or whatever they are. He brought them also with him. He sat there and he shook his head and he rocked a little bit. I said, Lord, don't tell me I'm about to save the man from the mouth. So after church, he went to one of our greeters and said, I want to meet with your leader. Lady came to me, she said, well, Pastor, the man from the mosque says he want to have a meet with you. I said, take him in the conference room, sit him down, make them comfortable, offer them water, juice, tea, or something. And I'll be in there after I greet our morning guest. So my deacons said, Pastor, you're not going in that room by yourself. I say, I know. I'm taking the Lord.
All right.
So I went in that room. I sat at the table. I said, brother, what can I do for you? He said, friend, I'm just trying to find out. How is it you get all these people in this church every Sunday? You're parking past my mosque. And some of your people even park on our parking place. He said, I want to know how is it and what are you saying to get the people in here? And so he says, I want you to come to the mosque. And I want you to speak to my group.
All right.
And I want to speak to your group.
Yes.
I said, brother, let me stop you right there.
Uh-huh.
I said, well, when it comes to the community,
All right. We
can clean up the community.
All right.
We can get the trash off the streets.
All right.
We can feed the homeless in the streets.
Uh-huh.
We can clothe the naked in the streets.
Uh-huh.
But when it comes to worship,
Uh-huh. That's
where I separate it. That Jesus came down from 40 and 2 generations. I believe that Jesus was born of the Virgin Mary. I believe that Jesus was a sinless man who did no wrong. And he was prophet, priest, and king. And I believe that one Friday they stretched my Lord
businesses.